think the first thing folks are going to want to know is how you guys decided to make some music together.
Well, I was home in England, and I'd made one solo album called Outrider, and I was pretty desperate to make some more music because I'm very passionate about making music, both in the studio and especially being able to play it live at the end of the day. And I'd been wading through scores of cassettes of different singers, and I'm afraid I just couldn't get any enthusiasm for any of the singers that I was hearing.
I'm personally delighted that,
And I had a call from my manager. I guess this came in a roundabout fashion, and I think we both received individual calls. Mm. But the essence of it was, how would you like to work with David? And I said, I'll give it some thought. And anyway, it came to be that we decided to meet up in New York. I'll pass you over to David here, because his situation is slightly different.
Well, I was languishing in the Bastille for a period of time, of all the peripherals of rock business, with coming towards the end of, going into the 1990 with Whitesnake. I'd had quite enough, thank you. The moose abuse had actually gotten to me. And there was an assortment of reasons that I wanted to take a reflective period away from what is called the music business and sort out myself, and if I indeed still had the passion to continue in the music business. So I had about 3 weeks off, then I got this call saying, do you want to sit down with him? I said, yeah, absolutely. Very, very much so. I've admired Jimmy Page for way beyond the Led Zeppelin work, way back to when he was producing and as actual session guitarist, and it's still illuminating today to find out a lot of my favorite records he was featured on when he was sessioning in London. We met in March, the end of March in New York, where we actually stopped traffic when we went for a walk, which was a blast, and got on terrifically well, agreed, and we covered a great deal in a short space of time, and the most important agreement would be that we would take everything one step at a time. It was obvious we got on very well together. The next step was to find out whether we could actually write together. So I invited Jimmy to come up to Lake Tahoe, promising him 4 very complimentary seasons, and the day he arrived was all in one day, wasn't it, mate?
It was indeed, yeah.
Let me jump in for a second. Try to avoid starting an answer with well. Okay? Try to keep rolling.
Somebody's in for a good chin-in today,
yeah,
Neil.
Aren't they? You know, we've been friends for many years, Neil.
Yeah, until today.
Well.
What a way to blow a relationship, I mean, really.
Okay. All right.
You like being self-flagellating, don't you?
Yes, I do.
Inviting help, though, huh? So what happened then? What happened in Tahoe? Did somebody purchase the Ghetto Blaster at this point?
Yeah. All of the demos for the songs that we made together, I think, was the extravagant cost of $50 from Radio Shack. It was a little, what they call a ghetto blast or whatever. We left the complimentary roller skates at Radio Shack and decided just to leave it stationary. We are both accredited songwriters and both feel that the song is what is important to get the best out of what we would feel, what we would call a song. And if it stands up to that kind of nakedness, you know, the very basic primitive demo, then it can only improve with more finessing.
Mm-hmm. So what did those demos consist of, Jimmy? Is it just like, you know, a little bit of acoustic guitar and...
There are a lot of acoustic guitar demos without any doubt, but the very first one that we did was through an amp, an electric guitar through an amp, and we had a tape of some drums. It wasn't even a drum machine. I mean, this is real primitive stuff we're talking about.
The original.
But the first number to come out of this collusion between the two of us was, on the very first day, was Absolution Blues. And we pretty much got the whole structure of that together in the first day, plus some other ideas that were coming out. These ideas were just pouring out over that first week.
It's terrific.
You know? They were just coming so fast. We said, well, let's get this down. And then we came back and finessed them and rearranged them. And
so is that the point where talk became action. You had had a little bit on this tape recorder, and something said, "This works for me."
Not really. We still kept working on the numbers, and in fact, it was after we'd injected a rhythm section into them at a later point down the road, and just to see how it was going to work, you know. And what's your little clip here?
We invited a rhythm section up to give our creation life.
That's it.
That was about it. And God, they did it.
Yeah.
And with one leap, we were unbound.
And so from there, we went back and started writing on, you know, from the whole buzz, adrenaline buzz of this, yeah. You know. And it was some time into it, once we had a lot of material that we felt very comfortable with, that we thought, well, this is it, we should make the record.
The interesting thing is that neither Jimmy nor I had prepared anything in advance. We started with, in essence, a blank canvas, and just built it from there. There was absolutely no conscious decision to make a Lead Snake album. Forgive me, the naked puppets, it's very American. None of that. We just literally finessed, just little scratch ideas that both of us would just be inspired from each other. It was a wonderful melding.
How does it usually work for you guys? Do you find that on some tracks, like, you may have a certain idea in your head for a lyric, and then David will come to you, Jimmy, or how did you find it working?
We just faced off, and with acoustic guitars.
I need you to take that answer, start the answer again.
Well.
Ask the question again. How did you?
Oh, it was her fault. Good. Well back there.
How did it
well
work back for you?
There.
Yes.
Humor the artist.
Back to you. how did the process work? So you faced off with dueling guitars, or?
Dueling colodners. No.
The process.
So you said the process involved.
In essence, we sat down with acoustic guitars and this extravagant recording device and literally just teased tunes out of each other, worked on things, one thing led to another in terms of riffs or chord sequences and stuff. It was an absolute bonding of two, I'd like to think craftsmen.
Sure.
Were you both ready to work in a collaborative process? Because, for example, your last record you did pretty much on your own, Jim. And David, you'd been working in a band, but you've been really responsible for that band's growth. Were you guys ready to work with somebody else?
I certainly was.
I certainly was.
Fuck off, Neil. At that point of time, I was certainly looking to work with in a collaboration, certainly. This became a partnership as such, though, rather than just a casual thing.
And you, David?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I was very, very curious. I'm coming into my 20th anniversary in this job, and it was wonderful for me to rediscover hope. And also the fact that my passion was completely and utterly undiminished, and it was a great deal to do with this man. We had and still have a remarkable relationship. Both of us have, in essence, through our mutual careers, have achieved a great deal, but we've experienced a great deal along the way, which fortunately both Jimmy has learned from, and I most certainly have. So there was absolutely no ego in any way, shape, or form exercised by either of us. And certainly moments could have produced something negative, but everything we've worked on together has been absolutely positive.
Had you guys crossed paths before, as younger musicians, I mean?
We had crossed paths in the past.
Excuse me, as what? Younger musicians?
You just said you've learned from your experience.
Oh. Yes.
Had you guys crossed paths before?
We've bumped into each other in the past on possibly almost a handful of occasions.
Literally?
Yes. Usually in a club here or there in a town where both our respective bands may have been, but at no point had we ever appeared on the same bill on a festival or anything like that, or jammed together. So it was, you know, just really casual meetings. Totally informal.
And then what? David, what do you see as your common bond? Brennan talked to us about some of the, you guys talked to some folks last week, and musically, in terms of some musical tastes, you guys share a lot in common. What do you see as a common bond?
The blues.
You're gonna have to restart.
Actually, we've got, 30 seconds?
Yes.
Okay, let's roll it out.
Our roots are the blues.
Yeah, the blues! The blues are rock!
Oh, Neil.
Mark.
That's a dog with a hair.
That comes to mind.
I would say Shake My Tree would be one of the favorite tracks at this point, you know, in reflection, thinking about how the demos were growing and everything and how we were working on them. That's one that we knew right from the start that we had something really good, and we weren't allowed to let it rest until we had, got the best out of it. You know, we revisited and molded it. And it probably took about 3 or 4 days of work. Now, that's not complete days. That's sort of a 4-hour day or something. Concentrate. The rest of the time, we're having a good time listening to music.
Yeah, indeed. Our mood
I was city. I was exploring his record collection. No, but that one, seriously, is I'm very proud of that. But then again, I'm very proud of all of it at this point. Extremely.
Had to be put him on the record, huh?
Yeah, it's true.
Hang on, Philip, I need you a touch wider on the two shot. Okay?
There you go.
How
about in the bio they talk, you guys talk about creative partnerships. Can creative partnerships be assembled, or do you have to wait for them to happen?
I think you're extremely lucky to have a creative partnership. Doesn't necessarily mean that you have two people of standing reputations in one room, given two guitars or a piano and a guitar or whatever, and that they're going to come up with anything that's really, magical as such. And we were very fortunate.
Mm. This was not a corporate suggestion on anybody's part. This was within an intimate...
Start that over, I'm sorry. Just start that. This was not a...
Why?
...corporate suggestion because of Jimmy's cough.
Oh.
I want a clean entrance.
It's me again.
Bitch. This in no way, shape, or form was any kind of corporate maneuvering to put us together. It's an absolute coincidence that we share with Stablemates and Geffen Records. The timing was right, and that karma or destiny or whatever for both of us. We both agreed not to be dictated to in any way, shape, or form, because obviously the putting us two together, that potential Lead Snake connection, this wasn't corporate at all. This was curiosity, and we sat, and it worked magically. It really was a magical exchange. And I think, I know that we got the best out of each other, that we were, at this particular time in our lives, this is the best that we can do in our chosen field. It's, I think, lessons learned from the late 60s and early 70s of forming groups on paper, because this was a great guitarist, this was a great drummer or whatever, without taking into any consideration chemistry, characters, attitudes. We've been through a great deal of all that in that particular school for scoundrels, and unfortunately emerged relatively unscathed to be able to put all of that knowledge to very positive use.
Live to tell about it, huh?
I impressed the shit out of myself there.
Did either of you go in with preconceived notions? Did you, Jim?
We didn't go in with any preconceived notions, actually. And as I was describing previously about the Absolution Blues, that's just a lick that just came out of thin air, as did many of the subsequent licks which followed and called sequences and riffs. I did have a few bits and pieces tucked away from the past, but I only really plundered a couple of those, from my old demos I'm talking about, because most of it was just coming out fresh, so there was no necessity to sort of, scratch one's head and think, oh, what are we going to be doing next? It was just pouring out.
Mm. Absolutely, absolutely no frustrating times. Jimmy mentioned the song Shake My Tree, which was the only... it started off to build, and the reason we took a couple of days over it was we didn't want it to be cliched. Mm-hmm. It would have been very easy to have gone into a particular sequence, well, a myriad of choices, mm-hmm. and we really had a feeling that, this could be really, you know, a powerful, anthemic tune.
All right, hold on for a second. Philip, you can go from the very wide two-shot to the little tighter two-shot. That'll
okay.
Work for me. Not hold so much on the
thanks.
You do it, right? Okay.
Yeah.
And, Carla, sorry, guys.
What kind of reactions did you guys get from other people? Sort of curious, like from your friends that are musicians, or you said that people started coming up to you and asking you if you were working together when people saw you together in New York. What kind of reactions did you get?
Well, the reaction we had when we decided to leave our representatives in a relatively upmarket bar and take the Manhattan air was not so much people coming up to us, it was the squealing of brakes and rear ending, which was impressive to us. You know, and the scream, are you guys going to be working together? We both looked at each other and went, this could be special. But the common sense factor was still, let's see whether we can write together and how, you know, how it would go.
We were perfectly prepared to just shake hands after a couple of weeks if it hadn't happened, and just keep it very quiet. Mm. But it was quite the opposite.
Sort of like being set up on a date when you've known each other for a while.
We were the musical blind... Oh, forgive me. We were like a musical blind date.
That worked. We should talk about some of the other tracks on the record. Perhaps we should start with, since we've talked about Absolution, which, as you said, was the first one. The first single is going to be Pride and Joy. How did that come about? Did your guitar start the duel, or did yours?
The song Pride and Joy, which is the first video from the Coverdale Page album, I came off, I had an introductory riff, which I thought would be rather jolly to present to His Royal Darkness. And after he'd paid me the compliment of visiting Tahoe, I said, okay, it's up to you to pick a place for us to go. Because, I mean, I think we'd pulled all the vibes out of Mother Nature up there. And we'd run out of movies as well, I think, at the time. So he, who shall be obeyed, picked Barbados. So initially, that song was called Barbados Boogie. And of course, instead of this lovely, charming, lilting, hoedown, toe-tapping piece, he puts in this riff from hell and changed the whole colorature of it and had me screaming again at my age. So,
which is something I read you weren't particularly inclined to do. If somebody would have asked you before this project began.
No, when my questioning my passion was there. Towards the end of the Whitesnake 80s, going into 90s, I really started feeling that all the peripheral aspects of the music business are absolutely nothing to do with the reason I got into it. Similar to what we're doing, actually, now, here. So I really wanted to take a bit of time, and I thought, I'm sure I can express myself as an artist competently lower and mid. I've always felt I've had a whisper to a scream voice anyway. And up there in the vocal stratosphere, there's only a certain amount of gymnastics one can perform. But that, of course, that was before JP, you know, who gave me some very interesting keys, bless your heart, to perform some acrobatics on. But I didn't have any kind of fantasy that I was going to become the Pat Boone of the 90s or anything.
Weren't looking for Pat Boone, were you, Jim?
I certainly was not looking for Debbie
Boone.
But if you're the Prince of Darkness, what is David?
Huh? Oh, at the moment, Prince of Light, isn't he?
Oh, dear heart, yes. Mr. Glitter. I tell you what, I'd really rather it was your problem editing, Neil, rather than cut us off in when we're having fun.
Because we've got a minute. I know it's difficult, but if we don't hear her, we don't know what questioning you're answering.
Mm-hmm. But I thought you were putting her questions to whoever received this.
Not on the film. So that's why those sound bites are really important. Did you get it?
Yeah.
David's vocal approaches, he has many different timbres to his voice, many textures. I mean, as far as, you know, we've been talking about the real high stratosphere vocals, you know, one, and he's a total vocal gymnast in this area. And the sensitivity and almost caressing quality of his ballad approach, you know.
In essence, he wanted the long chainy vocals.
Yeah. The chest beater, come on.
Yes, chest beaters don't grow on trees, Carla. You know? The unfortunate thing is when we met in New York, the loincloth was at the cleaners, you know, being pressed flat. Jimmy is a sonic architect in terms of his structure. It's the most interesting, he's without a shadow of a doubt, regardless of his legacy, the most interesting musician I've worked with, because of he looks at the song as a song. And how he can complement the theme of the song as a musician, as a guitarist. Whereas a lot of musicians use it as an excuse for showing off technical expertise or whatever. We both are fans of songs, and he is an accredited songwriter, and so am I. So putting it together and looking at the song and the dynamic of the song, I like to use my voice similarly to the way that Jimmy uses the guitar, which is to caress a vocal or to grab it by the short and curlies, you know, whichever the music is lending itself to. Mm-hmm. The circumstance is that I do enjoy a variety of, for instance, Sinatra, the phrasing of Sinatra, whatever. I log all of this into the mental blender, you know, to be utilized at a later date. It's just a learning experience.
I'd like to go through some of the record track by
Do you track. Mind us looking at your microphone?
Well, I hadn't really thought about it until you decided to bring
because
it up,
I'm,
Mr. Coverdale.
I'm going to look fucking drunk. I'm wearing the eyelids of the morning.
Well,
here.
Darling, you'll go blind with the Barbie twins.
I'm still a Coverdale to Sinatra. Next record.
Only the lively.
I heard shades of What's New Pussycat at the video shoot the other night.
Hey, wow. Delilah's a killer. Fry Me a Baboon is a particular party favorite.
The only question remains is which ones did Jim play on?
I read. Who's this Jim you're talking
about? Yeah, I prefer Jimmy.
Jimmy
is. Well, it's just going to be J in a minute, isn't it?
The JP is yours, right?
Could you enhance the soundbite a little, please, Carla?
I wanted to ask about, it's not mentioned which songs, but in the bio interview you guys did, you talk about a lick that that Jimmy plays that, for the life of you can never play.
It's actually the lick that irritates me most. Licks that irritate me most by Mrs. Coverdale's little boy. When Jimmy first played the introductory guitar riff to Shake My Tree, apart from the fact it was, what's he doing? It was this blur of fantastic fingers. That's what he rejoices in that I can't copy. Because I play a little guitar, you know, but only for composition. But I do like to think I'm a guitar stud, don't I, now and again. I go into flights of fancy when he slaps me around heartlessly and coldly and... but yeah, that's something that is going to create a few manicure problems for guitarists trying to do that guitar lick.
It's curious because that is one of the licks that, as I said, I didn't really plunder anything that I had left over from the past to a minimum anyway. But that one I did have, that lick in the sort of verse idea. And that actually goes back to the days of Zeppelin, actually, when we were rehearsing for In Through the Outdoor. Nobody could see at all what it was all about. And I think I might have brought it out when I was working with Paul Rodgers as well, but David immediately latched onto it, which was great.
Oh, you know. I'll have that, that's was my right. mental thought.
That's right.
I shall nail that to the back of the arena, thank you.
Yeah.
Sounds like you did, huh?
Sure did.
For those that might know you as a virtuoso on the guitar, little do they know that you also have harmonica skills.
Ah, yeah. But I used to play harmonica. I was booked to do harmonica sessions when I was a studio guitarist. You know, I'd just go down and play harmonica and, you know, a few things anyway. And I hadn't really played since those days. And I just felt the number would be really good with a harmonica in it, in Pride and Joy. So proceeded to do it, and it was fun playing it again, you know.
We actually, when we made the demo of the song in a pre-production circumstance in Reno, Nevada, I came in, it was my birthday, and his birthday present for me for the rest of the day, I could say it was me playing harmonica. And after that, it was back to him.
Snatched it away at the end of that 24-hour period.
Ooh, don't say snatch.
How much time? You've been working too hard, huh?
Probably 3 minutes of time.
Okay, come on, Paul.
4 minutes. Keep rolling, you can say snatch.
Thank you. Can we say pussy as well?
You can say it now.
Okay.
As those 3 minutes roll out.
The electronic pussy kit. Pussy cat, sorry.
Get David the auto sock.
Okay.
Okay. Keep rolling.
Well, you've already talked about Shake My Tree. How about Waiting on You? Do you want to feel that first?
There was another song that somewhat perplexed me when he came in with his what I think I called JP's wacky chord tricks, wasn't it? Something like that.
Yeah.
The verse ideas and stuff for the song Waiting on You were a doddle. I'm just a meat and potatoes, nuts and bolts singer, other than the chest beating, the bravado. But it came to what I would feel we could call a chorus line or a potential hook line. And there were all these weird descending, I'm going, oh dear. I said, that's the guitar solo, is it? That's a bit quick. Unfortunately not, that was the hook line. And that completely and thoroughly evaded me for a while. And then one morning, I just received the signal from God. And he said, just sing straight through it. And I called him up and confused him by saying, I think I've got this great Motown lick for Waiting on You. So there was the silence at the other end of the phone. I said, well, I'll wait till I see you and I'll sing it. But we both were very happy with the way that came out. But it was interesting because what I got out of it is that you can get into a particular position where you feel what's left. For instance, when I was saying I'd had at that particular time enough of the vocal stratosphere, but with working with him, it was just the inspiration to fly, to soar. And it was evident to me that you can teach an old dog new tricks.
A Motown?
Or the black dog can teach this new old dog some tricks, very much so. It was a great learning experience working with Jimmy.
A Motown lick? Was that what you had in mind?
He lumbers himself with this Motown lick. You know, it has nothing to do with Motown.
Oh, it's all this.
He'll still keep saying it. Listen, go on, go through it.
No, he goes, no matter what you say, no matter what you do, this heart is dedicated. All that stuff. I just see Diana Ross.
Yeah.
Honest to God, I want a pearl necklace and a wiggly butt.
But I actually,
an assortment of wigs.
When we were working on this, David came up with the melody for the verse almost immediately. You know, it was just there. And yes, the chorus had hung around for a little while. And I actually had a melody for it, which I was holding back unless we really got.
He and I agreed to meet in New York at the end of March in 1991. We sat down and had the obligatory glass of wine, and nice to see you looking so well.
He lumbers himself with this Motown lick. You know, it has nothing to do with Motown.
Oh, it's all this.
He'll still keep saying it. Listen, go on, go through it.
No, he goes, no matter what you say, no matter what you do, this heart is dedicated. All that stuff. I just see Diana Ross.
Yeah.
Honest to God, I want a pearl necklace and a wiggly butt.
But I actually,
an assortment of wigs.
When we were working on this, David came up with the the melody for the verse almost immediately. You know, it was just there. And yes, the chorus had hung around for a little while. And I actually had a melody for it, which I was holding back unless we really got stuck. And then when he came out with it,
making me suffer.
That's right, absolutely. But when he came. When he came through with this melody, I, you know, it beat my one hands down, so that was really good, you know. No contest.
We were a great inspiration to each other and very encouraging. A lot of people, I would imagine, with Jimmy or myself, are somewhat intimidated because of whatever we've done. And we settled with each other immediately and really, you know, for me, it was an enormous inspiration to work with somebody I'd admired for so long, and certainly learned from and copped from too. And it was a treat. It was the most refreshing experience I've had for a long, long time.
See, you can torment him some more. He'll live.
All right, let's cut there because we're running out of film. That was a very good
interview.
Okay, let's take about a 10-minute break. We got to reload some.
There's also my right here.
The Wizard of Woz.
The Widow.
The Widow.
Blah, blah, blah. The blah.
You're wrestling with the language again, Trace.
I know.
Be careful of it lenses in when you pat it.
Mark. Ooh.
A dog with a hair lip.
Okay.
And, okay, Carl.
All right, so next up is Waiting on You. Do you want to start?
Well, I thought it was taking me for a little
while. No,
fuck, I was already
for a little
while.
My mistake.
Just can't get the start.
Thank you. Take Me for a Little While was a verse and chorus sequence that I'd written during the point that I was staying up at in Tahoe, in the accommodation I had just down the road from David. And I presented it to him the following morning. And
what was that place called again? The Sheik's Delight, wasn't it?
Probably. So, and David took a grasp to the mood of it immediately. And I'll pass you over to David here, because, I mean, the lyrics are quite important.
What we wanted to achieve, I think, with Take Me For A Little While was a reflective piece. We've both had a great deal of tragedy and loss in our lives, certainly people extremely close to us. And the music itself lent an air of sadness and reflection to me. And in essence, the lyric was almost immediate. In fact, the hook line, the chorus was, the dreams we've lost and stuff. I saw Jimmy and I sort of sitting, reflecting, you know, years on or whatever. And this song was that kind of image, you know, reflective piece. Thinking all the sacrifice, a great deal of sacrifice in being a musician about town, you know. And I think we caught a nice mood throughout, and beautifully played by our associates in the studio too. Very sensitive song.
How does it work when it's a song like that that maybe taps into something a little bit sadder, more melancholy, or if you're missing people, do you take a lyric and say to Jimmy, hey, what do you think? This is kind of the way this spoke to me. Is there any kind of, do you guys go back and forth about this at all?
Well, in essence, related to all the lyrics of the album, I presented everything to Jimmy. Nothing was etched in concrete until he felt that this was an approach. This wasn't me. Most of my lyrics, the majority of my lyrics, are personal diaries. I just don't name names. And some of them are joyous and celebratory, and some of them are embittered, cynical, and derogatory. We'll get to that track in a moment. But my experiences certainly aren't unique. And there was a great bond once again. You know, it was very necessary for me to have my partner be able to live the lyric as well as, you know, just be mm-hmm. the guitarist or co-composer or whatever. So there's a touch of definitely a mixture of us on everything. On everything from top to bottom. From drum patterns, which is nothing to take away from Mr. Kamasi, but we really genuinely knew what we wanted.
And I want to ask you a question about that in a minute, but for the moment, as you predicted, some delve into some more bitter moments. Over now?
Hmm. That's quite an indictment on relationships and how they can go wrong. Oh, bollocks.
And go.
Action. Fucking be perfect.
No, we're still rolling. Ah. Action.
Thank you, dear. the lyrics on Over Now. Well, I'll start again. Over Now started off one of Jimmy's crunchy, malevolent, dark chord sequences and a particular groove and tempo that is very appealing to me. And I just felt the mood of the song was dark. And so I took a chapter out of my particular life, and we actually discussed, because he's had the same kind of experience. When your actual partner isn't all they're meant to be, and it takes a little bit of time for you to actually realize that. And afterwards, it's kind of an exorcism just to dispose of it, you know, by actually writing that kind of lyric. So now it's over now. You know, but this is a testament to a particular time and a particular person.
Did you write something, when you wrote it, did you imagine that it would call up the images in David's head that it did?
No, not exactly that, you know, the way that it came to be, but it was certainly totally sympathetic, and so I was 100%. You know, in favor of it.
Let's see.
Moving on to something jolly now.
Which actually it is.
It's a mood up.
Which actually
call Marvin Mitchell.
It is. Feeling hot?
Yes, as a matter of fact, yourself. Pass me a towel.
Well, feeling hot's there.
Can you start with that well? Sorry, Jill.
Up for a chinning.
Feeling Hot's one of those real fun rock and roll numbers. Yeah, it's got all the energy that was really there, bubbling away within the writing period in those early stages. I mean, it's got all of that adrenaline pump. And all the way through, well, once we'd finished putting it together, we were saying to each other, well, this is like the opening track when we do the live show, you know. It's just, it's got all that energy and...
It's
a damn good track as well.
Jolly, it's a jolly, jolly piece of music. Yeah, it simply won't let go.
David, do you mind reprising yourself with the song title again?
Mm. I think Feeling Hot, the song Feeling Hot, was probably the second piece that we got our knives and forks into. And that just rolled. That's as we wrote it. I think Mr. Page finessed a couple of the outro licks. What we wanted was both of us are fans of a remarkable cross-section of music, and one of the things that we enjoy is that kind of 40s swing. And a lot of the guitar licks and the melodies, the counter melody to the vocal, I've always imagined, you know, four saxes, four trumpets, trombones, you know, ba ba da da ba 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 da da da. You know, real, and being driven by Gene Krupa, you know, whatever.
Instead, it's a guitar army.
Yes, it's the Jimmy Page brass ensemble. I personally enjoy that immensely. I think it's screaming to open a show. And yes, we are boys. Any questions?
There will be.
It sounds like it wrote itself really fast, did it?
The song actually wrote itself very fast with a lot of us in it. We were just innocent bystanders to the song.
Channeled it?
Yes. It's crystal ball lyrics too.
How about Easy Does It? Would you like to go first this time, Mr. Coverdale?
The song Easy Does It, the lyrical theme on that is related to partners, when one of the partners is involved in a very high focal circumstance, actually like a musician. And the compromise is that certain aspects of one's private life have to go through. for instance, at parties, there's much more attention or whatever focused on the one who's supposed to be well-known or whatever, than their partner. And at times it can be very hard, very emotionally difficult for people to come to terms with that when they have such a closeness in a living environment. And this is a kind of, don't worry, you know, this is for us rather than, you know, don't you be running a hot bath and putting the Wilkinson sword edge on the side. Everything's going to be fine, you know, so just easy does it.
An apt description?
Sure.
He's easy, huh?
Oh, no.
Start with Jimmy for the next track.
Which is actually a track I liked a lot. Take a Look at Yourself.
Take a Look at Yourself. Came out of a chord sequence which we'd worked on in Tahoe, but it was more of the reflective feel of Take Me for a Little While.
And we had one of them, didn't we?
We had one of those already. And it was during the period that we had in Barbados that David came up with another section to it, and we tried it in a different tempo. And that's the way it went.
Well, the thing also related to the Take a Look at Yourself song, as Jimmy says, he had this, it was bringing out quite a maudlin melody from me. I have us on video sitting in a corner, and it's like old, you know, Simon and Garfunkel, oh, I want to go home, all this stuff. But the sequence was really attractive. And we sort of put that to one side because that wasn't, as you would say, writing itself. So that was put on one, the back burner.
Put on hold.
Yes, indeed. And revisited in Barbados. And it's both of us are of the feeling that if in essence it's a good song, it can lend itself to any kind of treatment. I mean, as we say, the majority of the songs, even the real biting rock stuff, in essence were given birth on acoustic guitars. Because when he plays acoustic guitar, it's just as intense and as fiery as when he cranks it up on the electric. But this particular song, market.
In Barbados?
Yes, the should have think certainly on Take a Look at Yourself, or how what turned into Take a Look at Yourself. The versatility of them, because he is a songwriter, as we discussed earlier. So the versatility of a good chord sequence can lend itself to any rhythmic approach. And we were just jamming around on the sequences, and it started to turn into a more R&B flavor than we actually, and both of us, of course, enormous R&B fans, certainly the Stax Vault period of the 60s. And it started to build in that way, and both of us, it was the kind of immediate, well, this is what we were missing before. But it took a little time to get there. No hair pulling or anything like that, it just evolve naturally, but it is related to another common belief related to our love of songs, that the sequence was versatile. We could have done it slow. In fact, we have an acoustic version of the song, which is a very intimate translation of interpretation of that particular piece.
Simon and Garfunkel, what do you think of that?
No comment.
No comment, mate.
Well, actually, we already talked about Absolution Blues. So the last one we need to speak about is Whisper a Prayer for the Dying.
What about Don't Leave Me This Way?
Don't Leave Me This Way.
Oh, I apologize. You know the order here better.
The Russian in her.
What about Don't Leave Me This Way?
Well, don't leave me this way. Is
well.
Fuck it. I knew I'd done it when I did it.
I know, yeah.
You maybe. Answer it. You can answer this. Go on.
Okay.
No, well, you do it. Go on.
Well. Don't Leave Me This Way. I'd had the initial introductory guitar sequence for many years. And I'd actually introduced it to former associates who simply hadn't taken it any further, who maybe found it dull or whatever, I don't know, but it certainly didn't inspire them. And I presented this as an idea to Jimmy, who flew on it immediately. Yeah, I've, once again, as I keep saying, which is certainly not in any way, shape, or form blowing smoke anywhere close to his derriere, that I've adored his work and his philosophy of build and the dynamics that that he arranges his music with. And that has been an enormous influence to me over my career. Because he got it right, I didn't. I'm just still learning here. I'm his apprentice. And he flew with the song. And that was one of those natural building songs which just rolled. We didn't really have, right, we're gonna write a 5-minute song or whatever. It was, the song was over when we'd done thrashing it about and abusing the bugger out of it.
What happened when David gave you this guitar lick and you were a little more appreciative than perhaps others he may have known?
Well, we worked on it together. You know, I came up with a cool sequence, etc. You know, but the most important thing about this is David's vocal was really incredible on this. And I really enjoyed putting the guitar phrases on with it, which weren't going to get in the way or cloud, you know, run over the vocal phrasing. But to complement it and be totally there, you know, as almost a little duet going through.
Well, that's your whole focus anyway, I think. Mm. You know, you look at the song, that's the phenomenal bonus for me. Jimmy's, you know, allow me to return his compliments to me. The guitar solo is staggering. He seems to be able to sum it up in a much shorter space of time than I do. I have to go on and on. Perfect compliment to, I think we put both on that particular song because of its nakedness. I think we both compliment and explore the theme of the sentiment of the song. I think it's a perfectly foiled and execution.
Without any doubt, a nod to the blues.
Yes. The old Cecil B. D. Mill, epic.
Do you think that people forget to treat the voice as an instrument, the same way they think of it as a guitar, as an instrument?
I think that most of the people tend to treat any singer in a band, particularly cab drivers, you know, oh, you're just the singer, you know.
What do you think, Jim? Do you think a lot of people forget about, the way you were talking, it sounds like you're talking about a voice the same way you're talking about a guitar almost. Do you think sometimes people forget that?
Well, I don't know. David certainly has the ability, as we were saying earlier on, with the vocal gymnast, you know, to be able to use his voice as an instrument, but also portray so much within the lyric that's, you know, that's the thing that is so impressive.
For both a musician such as Jimmy, stroke songwriter, I want to be a vehicle for him. For instance, if he was going to sing the song, this is how he would do it, because I would most certainly consider myself blessed to be able to interpret that sentiment as a guitarist. So I think the realization is the two of us.
Mm-hmm. And now, whisper a prayer for the dying. Do you want to start, Jim?
No, we'll pass this to David again, because this is mainly a lyrical content.
What, my living room war? The song Whisper a Prayer for the Dying was another one of the songs that came out of the Barbados visit. Strangely enough, for such a high, intense crunch rocker. And it lent itself, it suggested an alternative lyric rather than the celebration or the negation of love. And during 91, both of us were suitably horrified by the images of what for us was our first living room war in the Gulf. On a daily basis, sitting there in the comfort of a home and watching this appalling fireworks display over Baghdad and everything that was related, the loss. And just seeing all of things as they happened really struck a lyrical chord in me. But it's a juggernaut of a riff. like the tanks rolling. I mean, the song lent the image to the song itself. That, you know, the crunch, the intensity of the song.
So did some of the ideas for this song formulate really more around the lyrics first in this case?
Well, no, usually we built up, I would jam along when we'd be playing. And it was the image that lent itself. And once again, as partners, I discussed with him the approach that I felt the song should take on a lyrical front. And I think it's, you know, a very total experience. Mm-hmm. I mean, the guitar, when it comes in with a crunch riff, is it's just like tanks to me, just powering across the desert. And both of us sincerely hope that the song isn't too timely.
Bite your tongue. why don't you fill folks in a little bit on the players and the production of this record? It's been almost two years since you first met, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
How'd you make the record?
Okay, well, we were aided and abetted by our very good friend Denny Calmassi on drums, whose drumming was absolutely incredible on every track. I mean, he grasped the vibe of what we were actually, you know, when we put it to him, he got it immediately. You know, there wasn't any problem at all. And we started in Vancouver, laying down tracks, basically going for the drum tracks, because the studio up there, Little Mountain, is exceptionally good, has a reputation for getting good drum tracks. And of course, that's the backbone of the whole thing. After that, you're going to be layering on the extra instruments and voices. But we actually went from Vancouver to Miami and employed some of the local musicians down there, local bass player, studio musician, and also a keyboard player. And so those were the two from there. And then we just layered guitars, and we got to the point where we were working 72 track with these different instruments, plus David's vocals, etc. So I don't know how much 72 track is being employed these days, but it's quite epic, I can assure you.
Take a little while.
We're at the end of the reel. Okay, we've reloaded. One more to go.
That's a lot of tracks.
It is, yeah. A bit tired, actually.
So, Rick, did you get your coffee?
Actually.
And we are ready. Okay, wait for it to settle down. Okay,
cool. I wanted to ask you about recording analog, but just before you go on, you talked about your session players, and this is self-produced, yes, with your engineer?
This is
right.
From the beginning of this project, David and I were partners, you know, total 50-50. And we were going to produce the record ourselves between just the two of us. But Mike Fraser, the engineer, who'd worked on Aerosmith projects in the past, produced such a fine sound to what we were doing, and also was helpful as far as a barometer in certain aspects as well, that we decided at the end of the day to give him a co-production credit along with us. But it was right at the end that we decided that, but it was certainly on merit.
Sort of like the vice president in the American Senate cast the deciding vote.
Well, actually, he had the master tapes and he wasn't giving them back till he got a co-production.
Or he got paid.
Truth comes out. Jimmy, could you address some of the decision how to record the record?
I didn't get the question.
Could you address the decision of how to record the record? Brim said this was recorded
analog ploy.
Okay. We decided to record this in analog, basically because Mike Fraser was very happy about the decision, I might add, but we felt that to go straight onto digital with this, and especially with the amount of overdubs, it would lose a lot of the warmth. I mean, a lot of people are now coming back from digital recording and going to analog, but I mean, this was a decision we'd made way beforehand anyway. And it proved to be the right decision as well, because when we were mixing these 72 tracks, at that point, not all of them were 72, but at the most, 72 tracks, down to the final stereo mix. We were mixing onto digital and also the analog, and the analog was still holding up better. So in fact we only went to the final digital process right at the mastering stage, which is the final stage of the whole procedure. And that's it.
Are you surprised that not just yourself but others as well have come back to that decision to go to analog, even with all the spaceship?
No, not personally. It hasn't surprised me that other people have along the way come back to their old friend analog. No, not at all. Because a lot of CDs that I heard that were definitely just purely digital recording and nothing else were sounding very clinical, and you're losing some of the frequencies. I believe.
Yeah, it breathes. It's particularly for the style of music that we enjoy. Analog seems to be able to handle the crunch, the real dirty grungy stuff at the bottom end, which is no disrespect to digital equipment. I mean, it's magnificent. And the advent of CD has been a blessing for any musician, really, because usually the last time you hear your work in how it ought to be heard is the last playback of the mix in the studio. Unless, of course, like him, you've got your own studio. But it's wonderful technology. It's just that this particular approach that we enjoy, analog, lends itself much more as a pal, isn't it, than...
It's horses for courses. If you're going to be recording a classical session, for instance, with a huge orchestra, then you would go straight onto digital. But with all the overdubs that we were doing, we just felt it was better.
But we do have a secret there, which we're not going to share, how we keep the signal so fresh, of course.
Absolutely.
Yes. And that is our secret for us to know and for you to ponder.
That's why we're producers.
Remains to be heard from. How about touring? Is touring in the cards?
I think both of us feel that this has to be taken live. Mm. It really does. I mean, from the very beginning, we shook hands in New York just before we even sat down to see whether we could compose together, and agreed that if indeed everything did work out positively, that we would take it to the street and feature the slices of our careers. We will most definitely be featuring Zeppelin and Whitesnake, and certainly, as we're so very proud of the Coverdale Page album, a lot of that. And they all fit together very, very nicely.
One would hope.
You don't have to hope, dear.
It's a guarantee.
Yes.
How about you? I saw your eyes brighten up there when the word touring was mentioned.
Sure, I can't wait to get all of this on a live setting in front of an audience. It's going to be really exciting.
Were you thinking that while you were making this too?
No, not at all. I was just thinking about let's make a really, really good record, one that deserved to be made by the two of us. And we got the best out of each other without any denying of that. It's a fact.
There isn't anything on the record that can't walk off the disc and into the arena.
Sure.
Real loud and hard.
One would hope.
Touché.
Pardon me?
No, I'm
sorry. Who of the two of you would like to sort of, I think what we need, Bryn, is if one of the two of you could sort of re-summarize the meeting and just be conscious of how much time you take to do it. You know, like, don't look at me like that.
Like what, darling? That was my x-ray vision.
Are you using any of the previous stuff that was said about...
We just want to redo it.
I mean, because there's both two different situations here that we were in before we got together, so... You know, you really have to sort of put both of us in our separate environments and camps, etc.
Mark. All right. Do it,
gentlemen.
Okay, Dave,
go on. Jimmy and I agreed to meet in New York at the end of March in 1991. We sat down and had the obligatory glass of wine, and nice to see you looking so well, and blah, and all of those things. And everybody sort of very excited. And Jimmy and I decided to leave our respective entourage and representatives and go for a walk around Manhattan, just to, you know, just to chat, really. And it was quite a nice spring day. We walk out of the hotel into the street and turn the corner, and of course the squealings of brakes, and there's all of these shouts from cab drivers and stuff saying, "You guys gonna be working together and stuff?" It was a very exciting moment. And we both realized that this could be, if it came together, could be very, very special. Very special.
Happy, Bryn?
That was good for me.
I got a boner.
I want to ask two last questions. One more question about writing. Jimmy, maybe you could elaborate on this a little bit more, which is, there's something I read where you talk about performing live and how it's different and getting energy back from the crowd. Could you talk about that a little bit? You know, how that matters?
Well, you know what it's like.
You didn't say well, did you?
Took the words right out of my mouth.
Right. When you actually attend a concert yourself, you know what the atmosphere is like and how it builds and this waiting of a band coming onto the stage, you know, this build, and then they're on and the whole place erupts. Well, that's from the audience point of view. For the artist, it's exactly the same. There's a little bit of nerves and jitters as you go on. And it's just like this fusion between the two, between the band and the audience. And the band starts projecting this music towards the audience, and they pick it up, receive it, and send back all this positive energy. And it just builds through the course of the night.
It channels.
Sure. So that is, you know, that's a whole scene within itself. But as far as, if you ask me personally, the part that I play in this is that I always try to invent new things every night from the guitar. For instance, I'll change the solos every night, and not just, that's one of the things that's kept me fresh throughout my whole musical career, really, is just the fact of always not letting something, you know, that I did the night before be the norm, you know, and just do the same solo every night or whatever. And that's the exciting part of things.
And I understand you picked up the guitar here and there on the record. Will you possibly do that on stage as well?
It'll cost him. after doing that video shoot, my manicure was ruined for a start. You know, I had blisters on my fingers. I'll gladly thrash my throat on his behalf, but we'll see. I don't... I mean, he's the governor, isn't he? You know, the alchemist personified. So going on to the audience thing,
it's important. We've got a cut here. We're out of film.
Well, okay. Moving right along.
Here's what, Mark.
And
hold on this frame, right?
Yeah, hold on that frame. That's good. Tracy?
Yeah.
Okay, and action.
Hello, I'm David Coverdale.
And I'm Jimmy Page.
And as some of you may have known, that's Mede.
And action.
Hello, I'm David Coverdale.
And I'm Jimmy Page.
And as some of you may know, we have actually accomplished an album together, and we're very proud of it.
And as
a mother, well.
Oh, fuck.
Keep rolling, and action.
Hello, I'm David Coverdale.
And I'm Jimmy Page.
And as some of you may know, we have made an album together, and we're both extraordinarily proud of it, as we hope you will be.
And as an added bonus, we're going to be touring in the summer, so we'll look forward to seeing you then.
Yes. The album's out March the 16th, and have a blast wherever you are.
And cut. That was great. Let's just do one for safety. That was
perfect. Keep it rolling.
That was perfect. Keep it rolling.
Let's go.
And go just a hair tighter, Philip. And just camera lens up just a hair.
That's the
okay, fine. And action.
Hello, I'm David Coverdale.
And I'm Jimmy Page.
And we have made an album together, as some of you may have known or heard or meh.
And action.
Hello, I'm David Coverdale.
And I'm Jimmy Page.
And Jimmy and I have made an album together, surprisingly called Coverdale Page.
And to whet your appetites even further, we're touring in the summer.
Yes, the album's out March the 16th, and wherever you are, and whoever you may be with, have a blast.
Thank you. And cut. That was great. That's good for now. Yeah. Right, so now let's use the rest
Mr. Dainty.
Back.
Okay.
Well.
Well, well, well. Okay.
Well, as it happens.
Well. Well, I'll go to well. Wellen! No. Sorry, kidding.
Wrong. Uh-huh. Okay. And Helen's. Yeah, just go on real quickly, Helen.
Can you put it up my nostrils? Remind me of the good old days.
You're really wicked.
Wicked, wicked. Right. I love wicked. Wicked.
Undeniably
wicked.
Okay, and as soon as Helen's off. Thank you.
All right,
Carl.
Okay. You were just going to add? Were you going to add about playing live or?
In terms of in concert, Jimmy and I have actually jammed in various blues clubs whenever the mood has taken us, and without any kind of announcement or whatever, and just the adrenaline and the rush has been incredible. All we do is suck that in and send it back. And it's indescribable, the rush that you can get from an audience, because when you're a part of an audience, you're focused towards the stage, but when you're on the stage, you're on the receiving end of this enormous wave of emotion and adrenaline. It's the most energizing experience I've ever had in my life.
Does it remind you why you do this?
Oh, my home reminds me of why I do it. My vehicles remind me of
oh.
The ex-wives remind me. Well.
David, it would be good if you talked about playing.
If I didn't get married again, you must have had lunch with my manager.
Something I rarely do is to let somebody play guitar on an album, but I did with David.
Ow!
I did with David.
Me bracelet. He encouraged me, in fact. He encouraged me to play guitar on the record. And apart from it being a singular honor, it was an absolute pleasure to work with him.
Were you nervous?
Of course I was. As a matter of fact, more nervous singing in front of him, because I tried too hard. Because I admire the guy so much, and now we've developed a very close friendship. And I would try too hard. So it was very similar. I'd ask him to leave for an hour or so, and then say come in and then we'd discuss a different approach on this particular verse or whatever, and we showed each other the greatest professional courtesy, and still, with both of us were injecting suggestions or the inspiration or whatever, but we left each other to get on with our individual bits,
yeah,
whereas we mutually supervised all other overdubs and
that went for the guitar solos as well.
Yeah.
I've always actually just put them on just with the engineer. And that's it, I get a bit nervous,
But I try.
It's just better. Well, no, it's purely by the way that I play. I don't work out the solos, and it's all spontaneity, and so the less distractions there are, it's best,
Mm-hmm. Similar for you?
Well, no, usually I'm okay. I mean, anybody who turns around. For instance, both Jimmy and I, with whatever we've achieved in our careers, it can be very intimidating to people, and certainly intimidating to us, that, for instance, if I stand up and somebody says, give us a song, and I don't sing as perfectly as one would anticipate, it doesn't work like that. For instance, when Jimmy puts the guitar on, everybody immediately expects the first note he hits is going to be absolutely perfect. That's an enormous weight to carry around on one's shoulders. And I mean, I tried too hard when he was in the room. I'd say, do you mind, And both of us worked extra, once again, to compliment Michael Fraser. He was a great barometer for both of us to discuss with through the glass or whatever.
Bring out that little bit more.
Yeah, it was very inspiring.
Mm-hmm. You've talked a lot, David.
Well, no, you haven't said what's our favorite color yet. Go on.
You've talked a lot about being songwriters and about the song coming first. How do you know a good song? Does it have to be stripped away to the most basic instrumentation? I mean, you were talking about how you can take the songs arranged and transform it into five different kinds of things. What makes a good song?
Well, what makes a good song? Well, I think that related to songwriting, we feel that we've achieved some substantial slices of what we would call good songs. This is in our estimation of what we like in terms of structurally and not the cliched chorus or, you know, that particular approach.
Bryn said when you were talking to some folks from Japan last week, you talked about...
In pidgin English, yes. Yeah.
In pidgin English or in other English, about listening just to the acoustic demos and that really being a barometer. Did you find that to be so, Jim? Jimmy, excuse me.
Wait a minute.
The nudity, the nakedness of stripping the song down from all embellishments. Okay. Shall we just talk amongst ourselves?
Is that when you decide that it's a great song?
A true barometer of a song is naturally when you just take it back to the acoustic guitars written on or the piano or whatever, and it still holds up. I mean, you know, Elton John can show you this.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
It's true.
I just got one question. Yeah, describe this record in 10 words or less. Describe it for me.
It's a bloody marvelous piece of hard rock blues.
And we're bloody proud of it, too.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm fine. Okay?
Look a little stressed, though, Preston.
No, I'm fine. Brandon, are you fine?
I'm fine.
Cut, Philip? Yeah. Okay, it's a wrap.
Thank you, gentlemen. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, boys. Thank you, Carla.
Thank you, Carla.
So.